required. If you're not vaccinated, we encourage you to wear one. If you're at risk, good news, we've got live stream at home. We can help set you up with Facebook. If you don't quite know how to do that, we can do that. You don't have to have a Facebook account to get on and to watch worship. And we usually have our last three rows kind of set apart for folks who want to mask, who want to socially distance. I don't see anybody there this morning, but usually when those folks are there, they would prefer a wave to a hug or a handshake. I'm going to conclude a series on Galatians today. Pat Hanley is going to be preaching next week while I take some continuing education in the mountains of North Carolina. Don't feel too bad for me. It's going to be gorgeous. It's going to be wonderful. But it's also going to be intense. It's a full week of education, worship, prayer. I'm going to come back ready to rock. Rally Day is Sunday, September 19th. We're going to kick off Sunday school. We can have a welcome table out there for parents and children coming back to Sunday school. Also, that Sunday, after the second worship service, we're going to have a meeting for youth and their parents. We're going to be able to start a youth group this year. I think we've got the numbers to do it. I love youth ministry. I'm going to be personally involved with it Sunday by Sunday. So if you have youth who are 7th through 12th grade, or you know somebody who would like to, have them contact the office, have them contact me, but Sunday, September 19th, after the 12:30 service, we'll have an introduction to the year. Monica Harbs, Alex Nihlas, and Lorraine Mason is going to be there as well. They're going to be a part of that youth ministry team. We'll be celebrating the sacrament of Holy Communion this Sunday. If you'd prefer to receive a sealed communion kit when we go to pass it out, just raise your hand and Pat will be sure that you get one. Please join us for lemonade on the lawn after worship. Don't dash. Let's go meet outside and catch up. Any other announcements?
Yeah, the bulletin.
Oh, yes. So next Sunday, the 9 a.m., we're going to go no bulletin. We'll have some bulletins made. If you need to have a paper bulletin in front of you, we will have a few. But we're going to try to go no bulletin. So you can just praise the Lord. You can even throw your hands up if you want to, if you feel led to. But next Sunday, we're going to start that. We hope at the 9 a.m. to go bulletinless beginning next Sunday. Let's worship the Lord.
And they can pick up the prayer requests in the north. They can pick up the sheet with the prayer requests.
Oh, sorry. Prayer request sheets. So those are in the narthex. Those will be in the narthex also next Sunday. I know sometimes you want to take it home from the bulletin. They'll be waiting for you in the narthex next Sunday.
Please stand for our call to worship this morning. The call to worship this morning is taken from Psalm 96. It is a responsive call to worship, and it is printed in your bulletin. And as James said, next week it will be up on the screen. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is to be revered above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. Tremble before him, all the earth. Amen. Praise God. Please continue to stand as we sing unto the Lord a new song. Amen.
Away. It was my turn. till I met you.
Thank you, Jesus. God is good. Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, we thank you and praise you. We give you all the honor and glory that you so rightly deserve. Father, we come before your holy throne this morning because you told us we could come. Those who are bought with the precious blood of Christ can come boldly to the throne of grace for help in time of need. And we come this morning, Lord, your people. We come, Lord, just as we are. And we ask you to do a work in our lives. As we praise you, as we lift you up, we ask that all the shackles that hold us back, the things of this world, the concerns, the pressures, the problems, that they would just fall away and we would see your glorious face and that we would join in with the hosts of heaven in praising you and lifting you up. What a great cloud of witnesses right now are praising you, Lord Jesus, in heaven, and we come and join with them and lift up your amazing name. Worthy, we say, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Let's worship him. He is holy. Adore you, Jesus. Filled with wonder.
Holy, holy, holy.
Yes, we adore you, Lord. We praise you. You are so worthy, Jesus. Hallelujah. Work in the lives of your people this morning. Do a mighty work by your Spirit. Hallelujah. We ask you to come, Holy Spirit, and do this work. Hallelujah. Let's sing it again. Holy, holy. Come to your people this morning, Lord. Meet them, Lord, where they are. Be glorified in our midst, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. God is good. Jesus is Lord. Just turn to somebody, and if they're sitting way in the back, just wave to them. But if they're right out here in this area, you can go ahead and greet them in the name of Jesus.
Forward to your song, Ann.
All right, you guys, let's have a seat. Pat's told me I gotta take control. Let's go to God in prayer. Let's pray. You are a good, good Father. Amen. Lord, we know that you've given us everything. If we have you, we lack nothing. But we need you every day, Lord. We need you today. Pour out your Spirit upon us. Fill us afresh with your Spirit so that we may be your witnesses here and to the ends of the earth. Gracious God, we come this morning with so much on our hearts and minds. And so help us now to center our lives in you, to know that you are our solid rock, our foundation. The house that is not built on you cannot stand. Lord, we praise you. We lift up to you all those people, those situations that we have no control over, we can't seem to fix. Lord, we lift them up to you because we know that you are enough. You are in control. Gracious God, as the nations totter, as divisions grow deeper, we praise you and thank you that true unity can only be found in you, in the body of Christ. Father, we praise you for all these things in the name of your Son, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us now return to God our tithes and our offerings.
Good morning, everyone. This piece I'm going to sing, I call a contemporary Christian golden oldie, though I only heard it about a month ago, and it really touched my heart. And though I don't sing that much anymore, I really felt a calling to share it with my church family because the words are beautiful. Your love is irresistible to me, drawing close, surrounding me with peace. You hold me like a friend in time of need, and whisper in my ear, I'll be your strength, for you are mighty, holy, King above all kings, forever worthy is your name. The light of heaven reaches, setting my heart free. Your love is irresistible to me. Your love is irresistible to me. Picks me up when I am to me in mercy's covering. Your healing touch is making me complete, for you are mighty, holy, King above all kings, forever to me. For you are mighty, holy, King above all kings, forever worthy is your name. The light of heaven reaches, setting my heart free. Your love is irresistible to me. The light of heaven reaches, setting my heart free. Your love is irresistible to me. Is irresistible to me. Your love is irresistible to me.
once a quarter, Anne, maybe we could hear that once a quarter. That was amazing. Father, bless these gifts to your use, us to your loving and faithful service. Keep us ever mindful of those in need and all those who are near and dear to us. We ask this for Christ's sake. Amen. Fifty-two years ago, the Eagle landed. Two men inside, Buzz and Neil. These two were the first people to set foot on the surface of the moon. 4 days later, they returned to Earth, splashed down in the Pacific Ocean. No one had done this before. No one knew for sure if it would work out, if everything would be okay in the end. And a tremendous amount of work went into it. Patient, careful, time-consuming, to make possible the first day that the first people stepped on the moon. The space engineers, responsible for every part of the mission, at no point, right, did they say to themselves, I'm sure it'll be okay, it'll all work out in the end. They planned and tested for years, and the fruit of that careful, faithful work was the Apollo 11 mission. This is what we've been talking about. We've been talking about, for the past 5 weeks, now 6 weeks, bad teachings, bad teachers, and their effects. The big effect that a bad teacher has in your life is this: he, she, tries to get you to lead your life running at his pace. He sets the tempo. He lets you know when you're not keeping up. If you've ever had a bad teacher, you know they're trouble. They can mess you up. Bad teacher, it's not just someone that you had in high school, right? It can be a parent, it could be a friend, it could be someone you've never met, a kind of cultural icon who has that place in your life. Words of a bad teacher, they stick with you, they become a song that gets stuck in your head like a bad song you can't get rid of. We're finishing today because we want to focus on those teachings that we consciously or unconsciously follow. So it's possible to know, to be conscious that you're following a bad teacher or a teaching. You say to yourself, I know I really need to ditch that. I can't keep living this way. But that tells us something, doesn't it, about what we're really dealing with. It's not just, you know the right thing to do, so do it. It's deeper. We can find ourselves in bondage to a bad teaching, and know it. Someone who's been through addiction or has walked through that with someone else knows that firsthand. To follow a bad teacher or teaching means to come under the influence, under the power of another. It becomes a compulsion. We're being used, and we can even know that we're being used. It's also possible not to know it all, to not be conscious of it, until someone comes to you and says, I see this at work in your life, until you come to worship, and God's word and worship break you out of it. When that happens, we're even one step behind, step further removed from the person who knows that they're following a bad teacher. That's a long, hard road. Now, you may have in mind right now people who've suffered under the weight of addiction and its consequences, but the Bible says that that is the spiritual condition of every person on earth who does not know the freedom that we have in Jesus Christ. Paul's letter to the Galatians says this: it's possible to get off that road, and it happens by doing what we're doing today, worship. Hear the word of God, pray for God to apply his power, receive a spirit of self-control, turn away from the bad teacher or teaching, persevere in prayer and fellowship. Throughout Paul's letter, we find again and again, he wants to free his readers from what he calls a different gospel, one that brings no salvation, no peace, no grace. The bad teaching that we're looking at today as we close this series is this: it doesn't really matter what you do. It's all going to work out in the end. Don't worry about it. If you've ever heard that, heard something like it, we've seen someone who lives in that way with that bad teaching, that gospel in mind. Have you seen somebody like that? When that teaching is not explicitly religious, it's usually being taught or lived by someone with a kind of devil-may-care attitude. Charming, maybe for a while, but spend time with him, spend time with her. Invest your life with him, and that person takes you down with him. 5 years in to the relationship, the marriage, you discover the savings are gone. The promise, he's never going to see her again. It's broken again and again. You get the picture. The person who does these things and things like them, on some level thinks, I can make this work out in the end. It's going to be fine. We've got plenty of time. I can make it happen. When that bad teaching is religious, it comes in some form of this idea. Everyone will be saved in the end. Ever since Christ descended into hell, hell has been empty. The Bible teaches no such thing. It tells a very different story, and it's one that comes with a clear call. Choose this day whom you will serve. This is exactly the bad teaching Paul has in mind when he writes in the sixth chapter to the letter of Galatians. It begins at the first verse. Brothers, sisters, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But let each one test his own work, and then his reason to boast will be in himself alone and not in his neighbor. For each will have to bear his own load. Let the one who is taught the word share all good things with the one who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that also will he reap. The one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. The one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. Let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, especially those who are of the household of faith. This is the word of the Lord. It doesn't really matter what you do. It's going to work out in the end. Just don't worry about it. Paul's answer to that teaching, it's in the passage I just read. Don't be deceived. God is not mocked. Right? Sow to the flesh, reap corruption. Sow to the Spirit, reap eternal life. Paul's speaking of people within the Galatian church, people who have strayed. They've fallen under the power of another gospel. These are people who know their Bible. Right? They know their scripture. And that gospel is leading those people to what he calls corruption. It's not mincing words. The image Paul uses, it's a farming, a planting, gardening image, to sow and then reap. Paul's a tent maker. That's his profession. If you needed a tent for your business or to make a tent your home, he's your man. He could have used the image of setting up a tent, which can be done in a few hours of, yes, very hard work, but basically done in a few hours. When he was speaking about corruption and eternal life. But he uses the image of sowing and reaping purposely because it's not always immediately evident that that's where we are. We're headed toward corruption, eternal life. We can't tell that necessarily right now or in just a few hours. If, in Paul's words, we're sowing day by day to the Spirit, we'll reap eternal life. We're sowing to the flesh will inevitably reap corruption. To sow a seed, right? To patiently tend it, to water it, to provide for its growth, that takes time together. Paul, of course, is following Jesus in this, isn't he? The seed of the kingdom is planted, carefully, patiently tended. What help does Paul provide so that we can avoid this, step off the road to corruption? He has two things in mind. Paul says, begin with what he calls the flesh. He doesn't mean this. He means something different. He says, two, the only way out, the only way off, is perseverance in Christ in the power of the Spirit together, not on our own. So first, Paul uses the Greek word sarx. It's the flesh. By it, he means, again, not skin, not muscle, but human desires, human passions that are twisted to bad purposes. So why are human desires, passions, why are they part of the problem? The Bible teaches, Paul especially, that we have a problem called sin. I think most of us tend to think of individual sins, lying, stealing, cheating. But there's also something deeper, the power of sin, the kind of power that's resident in each person who does not yet know Jesus Christ. It's also there, but broken in someone who does know Jesus Christ. It's like a fever that was at 100, and now it's slowly going down over the course of a lifetime. Both of those things the Bible means by sin. Now, because that's true, our human passions, our desires, they aren't entirely innocent. In fact, sin as a power, if we ignore it, it combines with those passions or desires, and they create what I call spiritual termites. You're standing in front of a house, looks great from the outside, you're ready to buy, to walk in, start living in your home, but termites are slowly, where there's no termite bond, right? The cure is the second help that Paul provides. Sow to the Spirit. Instead, sow to the Spirit. Persevere with the Holy Spirit, with God. When God gives you his Spirit, we are not then Spirit-controlled, meaning God's taken over. It's impossible for us to sin against God, against one another. When God gives us his Spirit, we're given a spirit, it says in Galatians, of self-control. That's one of the fruits of the Spirit. Our invitation, and it comes with a warning, is to exercise that self-control so to the Spirit. How? In daily prayer, in time, in the Word, dedicated Sunday attendance. The Sabbath is set aside for this, for us to gather as a family, to grow together, despite difficulty, despite difference. Fellowship with one another outside worship, home groups. Service of those in need, those we would much rather keep at arm's length. If we're aware of the role that the flesh, what Paul calls the flesh, what it plays in our lives, and the cure that I just mentioned, then Paul says we will inherit eternal life. It means the power to follow him today and tomorrow and so on until the end of time when we sit with him at his table and enjoy bread and wine. He himself comes to the table to serve us. There's a wonderful Martin Scorsese film on Netflix called The Irishman. It tells this true story of Frank Sheeran. He's a Teamster and mob affiliate who's taken under the wing of a guy named Russell Bufalino, one of the most powerful mob bosses during the time of Jimmy Hoffa and the trustee and the Teamsters. In one scene, after doing a lot of dirty work for Bufalino, Bufalino gives Frank Sheeran a ring. It's like a ring of power that makes him untouchable. He's the only Irishman who has one. And Bufalino says as he gives it to him, "Do you know how strong I just made you? No one can touch with you. You're my son." This is a man maybe 10 years older than him saying that to him. Toward the end of the film, many years later, Sheeran and Bufalino are living together in a retirement community. And in a poignant, almost wordless scene, they share what? Bread and wine. A lot in their lives has been sown to the flesh, what Paul would say is sown to the flesh. Violence, greed. And now they're breaking bread and wine together, but it's not the Lord's body. It looks like a tender moment, but they're seated at a table of corruption that they've made for themselves. At the beginning of this message, I told the story of the first people to step on the moon. One of them was a Presbyterian. Joe Carter, an author and elder, tells us this about their journey to the moon. Buzz Aldrin was an elder at Webster Presbyterian. It's a church in Houston, Texas. Buzz told the pastor of his church that he'd been struggling to find the right symbol for the first lunar landing. He said in an interview, "We wanted to express our feeling that what man was doing in this mission transcended the electronics, the computers, the planning, everything. One of the principal symbols," his pastor said, "that God reveals himself in is the common elements of everyday life, traditionally, biblically, bread and wine." Aldrin continued, "I wondered then if it might be possible to take communion on the moon, symbolizing the thought that God is revealing himself there too. But there are many of us in the NASA program who do trust the Lord and who know him. Because there was enough gravity on the moon for liquid to pour, Aldrin wanted to pour the wine into a chalice from his church. Aldrin's pastor gave him one that was small and light enough to be carried. He planned to share the event with the world over the radio. But the atheist, Madeline O'Hare, had sued NASA after the Apollo 8 mission when they read from the book of Genesis on Christmas Day. So NASA didn't want more controversy. Aldrin was instructed to keep it brief and to the point. So after unpacking all the elements, he radioed back to NASA with this message. Houston, this is Eagle. I'd like to take a few moments of silence. I'd like to invite each person listening in, wherever, whomever they may be, to contemplate for a moment the events of the past few hours, to invite each person listening to give thanks in his own way. But then Aldrin read from John 15:5 to show where he was coming from. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever remains in me and I in him will bear much fruit, for you can do nothing without me. Neil Armstrong looked on quietly, but did not participate. Aldrin says, I poured the wine into the chalice our church had given me, and in the gravity of the moon, the wine curled up the side of the chalice, rising. It was interesting to think that the very first liquid ever poured on the moon, the first food eaten there, were the body and the blood of Christ. If we sow to the Spirit, we will reap eternal life. The end of our days will be celebration. The first food we eat, the first drink we have in the new heavens and in the new earth will be at a table that the Lord himself has prepared and that the Lord himself comes to and feeds us from. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. I want to invite our elders who have been called on to help us serve the Lord's Supper to come forward. I think we've got three of them. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord, you come to us graciously, in mercy abounding. You invite us, Lord, to this, your table, not ours, not mine, not a Presbyterian table, but the Lord's table. Lord, in coming to us, you remind us that nothing can separate us from you. Today, Lord, help us to hear that word in the word preached and now in the word presented in bread and wine. Amen. On the night before he was betrayed, Jesus gathered with the disciples in the upper room. And after blessing the bread, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, and after blessing it, he said this. "This is the cup of the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this also in remembrance of me." Friends, these are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Thank you. the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation, as soon as you receive, you can take. The cup of salvation. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Please take the hand of someone seated next to you. As together we say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Would you please stand for our last song? Words are going to be up on the screen. We ask you to sing with us, clap your hands, and just rejoice in the Lord. Amen.
Purpose, and we're everywhere we also be.
church. Here it is. Amen.